and later his uncle. Now, this young boy, as you can hear, did not live with his biological parents. And so what eventually began to happen is he had issues with navigating life without his biological parents. So he was a pretty good student in school, academics-wise, pretty good. But he had issues with conduct. And the reason he had issues with conduct is because one day he discovered something called parent-teacher conference. So he said, you know what? If I was to act up in class, or if I was to have difficulties in the classroom, then maybe, just maybe, my parents would show up to see about me. So after a while of acting up and being disruptive in class, eventually he got that great parent-teacher conference. So to him, this was a good thing. So he took the parent-teacher conference letter home, gave it to his grandmother. Of course, his grandmother was angry and said, you know, why are you excited about this? He said, because my parents will come up to see about me. They have to come to my school and see me and talk to my teacher. So he tried that once. It didn't work, unfortunately. All right, then he tried it again. Same thing happened. He took the parent-teacher conference letter home, but again, his parents never showed up. But what did happen that he had no idea would happen is that a person would show up that would forever change his life. And that person was his uncle. His uncle showed up, and from that very moment, his life was changed. He started to live with his uncle. Okay, and when he started to live with his uncle gave him a talk. First week he started living with him. And what he said, son, life is about choices. And right now I want to give you a choice. He said, the first choice is you can continue to be disruptive and have issues in the classroom, or you can use the fact that your parents aren't in the picture as positive reinforcement and reach towards success. So you might say, well, of course, go with the second one. Right, you need to reach towards success. That's what you need to do. But that little boy, he's thinking that, you know what? The success part, that sounds good. But if I don't do the first choice, then I might just be blocking out my parents even more. So what does it truly mean, people, to make a choice? We hear this word a lot, but what does that mean? Choice to me might mean something totally different to you, based on your lived experiences and also based on where you're from. So what does it truly mean again to make a choice? So let's look at dictionary.com. What do they tell us about what it means to make a choice? Okay, so an act or instance of choosing. Okay, whatever that means, all right? Second, the right power or opportunity to choose. Okay. The person or thing chosen or eligible to be chosen. Okay. Number four, an alternative. Alternative to what? Okay. And last, an abundance or variety from which to choose. So the first issue with these definitions, which is actually an oxymoron, is that how is a definition that actually has the word choice in them? Right? How does that work? So to define choice, we're going to include choice. All right, so that didn't help us at all. So we still don't know really what it truly means to make a choice. So let's try synonyms. They're going to help us. Oh, choice again. Okay, so to explain what it means to make a choice, let's put the word choice inside the synonyms. Okay, so choice, alternative, preference, option. All right, so people, what's that telling us is that we don't truly understand what it means to make a choice. Right? I'm a firm believer that how one views choice will affect how one may view someone else's situation. For example, let's look at the Southside of Chicago. Okay, Woodlawn community, Inglewood community. One that does not live in that area might say, well, those people should have a choice. Why are they being violent? Or why are they in these gangs? They should have a choice. They should go to school and get education, be positive. Right? But we're saying they have a choice, but we don't know what influences their choices. Right? We don't know what type of morals they have. What do their family structure look like? We have actually actually no idea. So since dictionary.com can explain which choice is, I'm not going to try to figure out a definition. But what I will do as we go along is, what are the ingredients to make a positive choice? What does it take to truly make a positive choice? Let's start with having hope. Understanding what it truly means to have hope. When I think of the definition of hope, an acronym comes to mind. And that acronym says, hold only positive energy. Okay? Again, hold only positive energy. Now, the most important word in that acronym is hold. One might say, how is it possible with so much negativity in our world and so much destruction and just issues in my life, how can I hold only positive energy? But it's not about always having positive energy. It's about, what are you holding on to? What we hold on to can positively or negatively affect our lives. For example, we're in so many types of relationships, right? Whether it's a friendship, a relationship with your partner, husband, wife, you know, best friend, associate, whoever. We always talk about relationships. Right? But sometimes we stick in relationships that we actually need to let go. But why do we stay in those relationships? Why do we hold on to them? Because it begins to be mundane. It's something we're used to. Like the people we love, we want to hold on to. We don't want to let go. We've invested time. But then eventually, when you let go of that toxic relationship, now you think, you know what? Maybe I shouldn't have been holding on to that. Maybe that wasn't best that I held on to something that was negatively affecting how I view people and how I view relationships. So people, what are we holding on to? What truly matters in our lives? Another example, you might be riding your car, listening to the radio, and a song comes on that you absolutely hate, right? But it plays a few times, and when you get out of that car, what starts to happen? You start to hum that tune, right? You start to sing along, and you stop and say, why am I singing that song? I absolutely hate it. Because what happens, people, is that the things we do, the people we listen to, what we hear, it subconsciously affects our everyday lives. Even when we think it's not happening, it is happening. Right? So what are you holding on to? How do you listen to that song, right? But then sing the song and then be done with it. How do you do that? Right? The first way is to truly understand what it means to let go of something. I want you to right now think about the five people that you talk to on a daily or weekly basis. Just think about those five people for a little bit. Now, those five people, do they tell you things like, you know what? You can do it. That dream, that aspiration that you have, that goal that you have, I believe in you. I think you can reach that goal. I think you have the potential to make it happen. Or do they say, you know what? Maybe you shouldn't do that. Maybe you should just go in a different direction. All right? That's probably not what's best for you. At that moment, you have to realize, what choice do I make? Who do I listen to? My friend should tell me what's best for me, but what do I really want to do? People, it's extremely hard for somebody to tell you what you can't do when they've never attempted or tried to do it themselves. Who are they to say you can't do something if they never tried it? Right? We have to sometimes think about that. Just because one says you can't overcome something, that does not mean that it's not possible. There's always ways to reach your goal. So who are those five people? Who are those people that push you? Or the opposite? Who do you listen to? Who influences your thought process? Who says you can get through? You can overcome the hump. You can reach your destination. So we look at hope, people. Hope has to be our destination, right? It has to be our GPS to reach our overall destination when times get hard in our lives. Another great ingredient to reach a positive choice is understanding what it means to have self-worth. What does that truly mean, to understand your self-worth? Now, if I ask maybe a group of people the self-worth of Oprah Winfrey, all right, or the self-worth of Bill Gates, or the self-worth of Steve Jobs, instantly a monetary figure might come to mind. But when I talk about self-worth people, I'm not talking about a monetary figure. What I'm discussing is, what does it truly mean to know self? What does it truly mean to love self? What does it mean to understand your skills and your talents and your abilities despite what somebody says you can't do something? When we know our self-worth, we understand then no matter what, we can achieve our goals. But also with self-worth, we have to also have self-love. Self-worth and self-love goes hand in hand. If we don't have self-love, we can't even begin to understand how to reach self-worth. We talk about loving people all the time. Loving a family member, loving a good friend. We always talk about the word love. But one thing we don't discuss as much is what does it mean to love oneself? What does it truly mean to have a positive relationship with yourself? Now, I'm not saying walk down the street and say, self, I love you. That's not what I'm saying. Okay. So what does it mean? How do we establish this relationship with self? Because once this happens, people, now we can reach the collective. Once we have self-love, now this self-love can reach out to the masses. Right? People can see that you have this self-love. Right? It's contagious. The energy just hits people once they see that you have it inside of you. So think about that. What's your self-worth? What type of self-love do you have within you? What relationship do you have with yourself? Not someone else, but what is a true relationship that you have with self? When I think about hope as well, a quote comes to mind. And it says, if we feed our hope on a daily basis, all of our doubts will starve to death. Okay? If we feed our hope, right, we feed positivity, right? The naysayers and the doubters, that negativity will starve to death because there's no way or no place for that negativity to live, right? So feed your hope, right? Feed the faith, feed the self-love. This past year, I have an organization called Speak H.O.P.E. And we did a lot of different community work around the city of Chicago. And this past year, we went to a homeless shelter. And at this homeless shelter, the guys and the women got a chance to speak on their situation. It was around Thanksgiving time. And when you first think about homeless people, you might say that they might be depressed or angry or not excited about life and might not feel good about themselves. But once they begin to speak about their life and their situation, that automatically told me that success and hope, right, are not always connected, right? Or success and positivity is not always, right, connected. Because as they began to speak, they talked about having grateful moments in their lives, right? They talked about being thankful for life, and they talked about the great things when it pertained to their family members and the people and the friends they have. They were positive, right? They had a positive nature about themselves. They didn't allow their external environment to become their internal mentality. They understood it was deeper than that, right? Just because they're going through a situation, that doesn't mean that's who they are, right? They did not allow the negativity in their environment to make up who they are as people. But most importantly, just because they lived in poverty, that did not mean poverty had to live within them. Right? Just because they go through a situation, that does not mean that situation made up them as an individual or as a person. Right? So as we think about hope, and we think about self-love, and we think about what it truly means to have self-worth, we go back to this conflict between hope and hardship. What does that truly mean? How do we connect those two? How does one go through a hardship, but also still begins to find hope? Another example at the homeless shelter, young kids were able to receive new or lightly used shoes. And they were extremely excited about receiving these shoes, all right? But the reason they were excited, yes, because they got new shoes, but the main reason is that those shoes in some way to them represented hope. It represented life. That yes, I live in a homeless shelter, but there's still hope for my life. There's still hope for my future. Somebody still cares about me. Somebody still cares about my life. So again, the curious case of hope and hardship, people. Isn't it really that curious after all? What it truly is understanding how to hold only positive energy. Thank you.